Well, here, I'm going to go through a little bit of a timeline and tell you what's been going on with us for about the last 3 weeks. Rebecca's last day of school was December 18th, and I guess it was a couple days after that, they called her at home and said, well, the teacher's tested positive for COVID, you've been exposed. She took a test and found out she was positive on December 23rd. And you just saw that picture up there of the positive COVID test. Let me just tell you, that is not one of the pictures you want to see in your wallet. I was pretty concerned about my wife. I mean, we've been married 46 years, and I thought, I could go stay with one of the kids or something like that, but man, I'm not going to bail on her when she's going through this. So I stayed at the house, knowing that was probably going to be I would get it, and I did. By that next Monday, the 28th, I had all the symptoms. Rebecca got me to go on Wednesday, the 30th. For a test because of New Year's. Didn't get the results till Sunday the 3rd, but I had it. My symptoms got worse Monday and Tuesday, and by Tuesday night, my oxygen level was low. We have one of those readers, and she says, let's go to the hospital. I went into the hospital Tuesday night at North Central Baptist. They wouldn't let Rebecca come in. You just kind of go in by yourself there. The first thing they did was take my temperature. It was 101.5. I was coughing and sore, but the thing that alarmed them, I had hypoxia, which that's when you're not getting enough oxygen into your organs and stuff. And my oxygen level was 77, and I could tell they were immediately concerned. And the doctor sits down on one of those rolling stools right in front of me, and he says, tell me about yourself. Tell me about your health. I said, I'm 66 and a half years old. I take blood pressure medicine. I take diabetes medicine. He said, anything else I need to know? And I said, yeah, I've had 15 surgeries in the last 15 years. And he literally rolled back from me like this and grabbed a phone. And he said, get this guy to emergency right now. And immediately, there's like five people in the room, and they're all acting like suddenly you're important. And it was kind of intimidating. And he looked at me, he says, tell me again about the surgeries. And I said, 15 in the last 15 years. And he says, we're going to work with you. And I thought, well, that sounds kind of ominous. So, and today, I can tell you this, I'm symptom-free, been for 10 days. Not contagious. I wouldn't be here if I was. I am very weak. Sore. But as I was praying about whether to preach this week, and I'd already told Matt like 2 weeks ago I would, but I thought I can always change that. But this week, 2 Corinthians 12:9 came on me, and it says, Paul's talking, he says, most gladly, therefore, will I glory in my infirmities, so that the power of Christ may rest on me. And that is my plan today, to be weak, to not have the energy I might normally have, but I want the power of Christ to be on me to challenge you. Romans 14:8 says, whether we live, we are the Lord's. Whether we die, we are the Lord's. Therefore, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. And I think I have a really good passage. If you have your Bible, turn to Matthew chapter 14 today. A passage that I'm well familiar with, but the Lord gave me a fresh understanding of this passage this week. And the first point of the outline is this. When it gets real, it will demand authenticity. When I was in the hospital, and when I told the guy about the surgeries, and immediately him picking up the phone, and all of a sudden people moving around, and then bringing in a stretcher and all that kind of stuff, I think the phrase that would get me, it got real. It got real. I don't know if it's ever been real for you, or if maybe if you were in a very serious car accident or something where it's not something you'd normally deal with. Well, this is when it got real for Jesus, okay? Matthew 14, verse 32. This is just before Jesus is about to be arrested and taken to be crucified. And the situation is going to take place in a garden, the Garden of Gethsemane. Verse 32, and they came to a place named Gethsemane. And he said to his disciples, sit here until I have prayed. And he took with him Peter, James, and John. He began to, look at this. This is Jesus we're talking about. We're not talking about Fred the farmer, okay? And he began to be very distressed and troubled. Who's that talking about? Jesus. And Jesus said to them, my soul is deeply grieved to the point of death. Remain here and keep watch. I'm surprised that's in the Bible in some ways. But Jesus could be heavy-hearted, distressed, with the emotional strain. I looked up those words, the Greek words for distressed and troubled, mean in the Greek, heavy-hearted, uncomfortable. And Jesus then goes on to describe himself, look, as deeply grieved at the point of death. Let's do a theology pop quiz. True or false? Jesus was half man, half God. False. False. What was Jesus? He was 100% man, 100% God. He was 100% man by birth, 100% God by nature. This is, if you take theology at Bible college like I did, this is the word for this thing that doesn't make sense. It's hypostatic union. It's the union of humanity and deity. And that was Jesus. So in his flesh, Jesus is experiencing distress, trouble, grieving. Spiritually, it's going to be something else. I think the thing that was impacting Jesus was not the physical death. He knew from birth that he came to die. He said, no man takes my life from me. I lay it down. He would tell people, look, this temple is going to die. And 3 days later, it's going to come. He was familiar with physical death. He could raise people from the dead. But the heaviness, the weight on Jesus that was compounding him in the garden was he was going to take the sins of humanity on himself. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21 says this, God made him who knew no sin to become sin in our behalf so that we might become the righteousness of God in him. Let me tell you something, that's the best news in the world. We got a family down here from Kansas City. of all things, my beloved, lifelong Cleveland Brown fan, are playing the family from Kansas City. And I still welcomed them to church. Nothing would make me happier for the Browns to win something. They've never even been to the Super Bowl. You guys are defending champions. If the Browns won today, it's not good news compared to this. He made him who knew no sin to become my sin, that I might have his righteousness. That is good news. We're going to get to a word I want to show you right now. In 1 John 2:2, it says, he is the propitiation for our sins, and not for those only, but also for the sins of the whole world. A picture of that? Propitiation? That little gold box there, that's the mercy seat. And that's where the Jews, once a year, would take the blood of a perfect lamb, and the high priest would take it in and spread the blood on the mercy seat. And the Father could not see the sins of the people because of the blood. That was the figurative aspect. Say the word with me, propitiation. Ready? Propitiation. Let's say it a few times. Propitiation. 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 Everybody needs a couple church words they know. Say it again without me. I'm going to tell you what it means. It's a two-part act. The first act, God hates sin. He hates sin. You know why he hates it? Because he's holy. He's pure. And anything that deviates from holiness or purity, he hates it. God hates sin. So the first part of propitiation says there's been something done to appease that, to take away that hatred, to absolve sin. And that's what Jesus did on the cross. He gave his lifeblood, just like the blood that went onto the mercy seat. He gave his blood so God can no longer have anger against sin, that sin has been forgiven by the cross. The second thing is, with propitiation, not only is the anger taken away, but now that opens the door for reconciliation, for moving into relationship with God. That's the great part of propitiation. He is the propitiation for our sins, not only us, but for the sins of the world. About this time in the hospital, as I'm being wheeled down to an emergency room, a lady doctor comes in. She said, all right, here's the plan, Mr. Humbert. We're going to have to be aggressive with you. We're immediately going to start an IV. We're going to give you steroids. We're going to give you antibiotics. We're going to give you vitamins. We're going to give you 5 days of remdesivir. And we're going to give you convalescent plasma. She says, let me explain convalescent plasma. I already kind of knew, but I let her do her spiel. She says, convalescent plasma is where we go to an individual. It's already faced a battle with COVID. And we take their blood that has the antibodies that proved to be strong and fight the disease in that person and lead them to health. And we give you an injection of convalescent plasma. She said, you understand? And this is what I told her word for word. I said, yes, I do understand. This is not the first time I've counted on the blood of another man to save my life. And she rocked back. And she's got the big glass dome on her head and there and everything. But I could tell from her eyes, she smiled real big and she put her hand out like this. Nice, nice. I take it she was a Christian or a vampire, one of the two. You know, you don't quit being yourself just because you're in the hospital, right? All right, the second thing I want to tell you that I learned, when it gets real, there can be new strength. I love that saying, strength will rise and we wait upon the Lord, wait upon the... You don't recognize that. I do in my head. It's a great song. You know what I'm talking about, Matt? Okay, good. Look at that. Wow, I impressed the music guy. The music guy. Wow. It just went down three notches in heaven. But anyway, Mark 14, verse 35. Let's talk about this new strength. And I tell you what, if you can picture, I've read these verses this week 30 times each, this passage over and over and over. And I get to this and I visualize it and my heart stirs in me like somebody just put it in a blender. Listen to this. And he went a little beyond them and fell to the ground and began praying that if it were possible, the hour might pass him by. And he was saying, Abba, Father, all things are possible for you. Remove this cup from me, yet not what I will, but you will. Yeah, everybody, I think most Christians pray. And I think we all have kind of a niche we pray in. Lord, thanks for this day. Thank you for this food. Bless the missionaries. Bless my family. Amen. Let me tell you something. When they're moving around with an urgency in an emergency room saying, Mr. Humbert, this is going to get tough. You might pray a little different. I'm not overly concerned with mortality. My favorite song in all Christianity is, This World Is Not My Home. I've got my dad, my mom, my older brother, and our youngest son all waiting in heaven. I'm not afraid of death. Just that I don't want to be busy when it happens. There's all this clutter going on and wires and cables and beeping. And I prayed a different way. It wasn't just my normal little prayer. It was really authentic prayer. Just like Jesus said, look, you pray, but I'm going further in praying. He went beyond them. That's what the Bible says. Did we already show that picture of Jesus down on the rock? There's Jesus. Picture what that might have looked like, going on by himself. Nobody allowed in the emergency room with him. No family. I asked myself at that moment at the hospital, is this how it ends? Alone in some sterile room, trying to breathe. But I can honestly say, I asked that question one time, and an immediately bigger question came to my heart. The question was this. Did you do everything you needed to do while you had time on earth? Did you really? Did you do your absolute best, Chuck? Felt no control. And when there's a lot, Rebecca knows, I like to chill. And I don't handle just a lot of stuff happening around me. Like if we go out to a restaurant and there's people around us, I get very itchy and just, I think I'm done. And then the hospital room was that was the worst possible. It's a small room. And it's filled with people. And they're jabbing me and taking blood and doing all kinds of stuff. And my hands clenched up. That's a natural human response to intensity. Your hands clench up. And I think I even told Worthy about this on the phone. And I said at that moment, I was completely intensely engaged in the activity. And then it was like a supernatural thing happened. Without me even being aware of it, my hands opened up and I could look down and they're open like this, like I sit there and praise. and a song came to heart. It's a really precious song to me. When I was in youth ministry, and we'd be doing these things called Super Summer I did it for like 28 years. And starting in the late 80s, all through the 90s, there was a song they would do at staff training. And it was this song that came to mind. And I want to play you the video. Don't watch the video. Just listen to the words. This song became my offering to the Lord at that moment. And it was the delight of my heart to mumble through it while the doctors are working on me. And the doctor, he doesn't know what I'm saying because I don't want to sing it out loud and ruin his day. But he said, I noticed how relaxed you've become. And he used the word serene. Enjoy this song. Just close your eyes and listen to it. COVID song right there. It reminded me of Acts chapter 7 when Stephen is being stoned, and he's not even aware of it. As the rocks are hitting him, he tells the crowd, hey, check this out. I see Jesus standing at the right hand of the throne of God, and the rocks are just pounding his face, and he doesn't feel it. In that moment, I forgot I was in a hospital. I was in a worship service. And I think of Jesus in the garden by himself. He knew what was coming. He knew it, he knew it, he knew it, he knew it. And yet he said, yet not my will, but thy will be done. And so I just, as I went through that psalm I had a couple times, I just said, Father, whatever your will is. You want to take me now, that's fine. You want to give me a year, that's fine. I don't care. Not my will, but your will be done. And that leads to the third point of what I understood. When it gets real, God changes the agenda. The toughest part for me were the nights, because they let you sleep. Well, they don't let you sleep. They get you up at 1 o'clock, 3 o'clock, 5 o'clock, every 2 hours. They're drawing blood, doing an EKG, doing your blood pressure, doing your blood sugar, giving you insulin, giving you all kinds of stuff, running the next IV. You don't sleep in the hospital. You just sit in that room, miserable. I'd be thinking about my family, my church family, and I'd be praying. And Jesus and Mark 14, verse 41. And three times he's asked for his disciples to pray with him, and they keep falling asleep. And he came the third time and said to them, are you still sleeping and resting? Look at these next three words. That is enough. Jesus has spent time with God, even without the assistance of his friends, and he's been loaded. He's locked and loaded. That is enough. The hour has come. Behold, the Son of Man is being betrayed into the hands of the enemy, of the hands of sinners. Look at this. Get up. Let's go. Behold, the one who is betraying me is near. Don't you love that? That Jesus has been fortified with the Spirit of God. And he's saying, get up, let's go. This is enough. It's time to get on with the cross. What a passage. Now I want to give you a curbside. You know, a curbside, that's what you take with you when you go. I have one more video clip to use, and I almost didn't use this because it's so cliche, it's so iconic. We've all seen something like this a bunch of times. It's a Rocky video. Yeah, Rocky Balboa. Hey, Paulie. Yo, Adrian, that guy. It's about a 2.5 minute clip, but I want you to think of this in spiritual terms. What does this illustrate? So get your sweatsuit on. Let's enjoy this. came to church.
Y'all laughing like I didn't do that.
Don't you love that? He had to spend in private the time he needed so he could be in, but in, the, be in public. I used to watch Rebecca teach piano lessons for years. And I'd think in my mind, because I know she'd do recital and stuff, the willingness to perform means nothing without the willingness to prepare. And Rocky, a big part of his movies was always the preparation. I need to go in private. I need to lift logs. I need to run through the snow. I need to lift tires. I need to chase chickens. I need to run up the steps of the Philadelphia Art Museum. I think Jesus did something very similar in the garden. Rocky copied it. Jesus did it first. But he said, it's going to get real. And I need to be ready. And the way for me to get ready is to put my face into the dirt and the pebbles and the soil and let the tears flow and pray beyond what others are willing to pray. And I need to get real with the Father. There's a passage, it's got to be one of my five favorite in the Bible. I would preach it almost every Sunday if I didn't feel like it would be burdensome. Isaiah chapter 50, verse 6 through 8. This was written 750 years before Jesus would go to the cross. But the Holy Spirit knew it, and he put this in the Bible. 700, that's like the age of our country about 2.5 times. And this is what the scripture says. Prophetically speaking, Jesus, I gave my back to those who strike me and my cheeks to those who pull out my beard. I did not hide my face from insults and spitting. For the Lord God helps me. Therefore, I am not disgraced. Therefore, I have made my face like flint, and I know that I will not be ashamed. He who vindicates me is near. Who will contend with me? Let us stand up to each other. Who has a case against me? Jesus knew he would go to the cross. He knew he would be spit on, beaten, whipped, crowned with thorns, nailed to the cross, and allow the sins of humanity be draped over him. And yet he says, you have no power against me. I give you my back and my face. Insults and spit are nothing. The Lord God helps me. Make my face like flint. You know what flint is? It's basically the hardest rock there is. For centuries, people used flint to shape other rocks, to shape metal. You could strike flint and it causes sparks and you can create fire because flint is so hard. And Jesus said, look, I'm making my face like flint. I'm not afraid of what I'm about to do. I'm not worried about it. I'm ready. I've spent the time in private. I've prayed up. I'm ready. I know I will not be ashamed. And then maybe one of the best smack talk lines in the Bible, he said, who will contend with me? Who's my challenger? There is none. Come over here and stand in front of me. Let's get it on. That's Jesus talking smack. Do you think you have a chance? I picture Jesus being at the bottom of the hill of Gethsemane, kneeling there in the sand and the dirt and the pebbles, and he gets up, almost like that Rocky scene. And physically, they beat him up, and they drag him up the steps of Golgotha, but spiritually, he set his face like flint, and he marched right up. No fear. He said, the weight of this world has had enough. It's time to get up and be who I am, the Savior of the world, the propitiation. And then, as he finished his time on the cross, victory swelling in him, he starts praying for the people, Father, forgive them. And then he says the three greatest words in the Bible. It is finished! No more offering for sin ever again. It's done. Nobody can add to or take away what Jesus did on the cross. Look, I don't know what your life is going to come to. But very well, you're going to have a cup come to you that you don't want. I really don't want this cup. I don't want to hear the doctor sit down in front of me and say, we need to have a real serious talk right now. I don't want the police to come to my door at 1 o'clock in the morning. I don't want to be called in to my boss and have him say, look, we're having to downsize. I don't know the cup you're going to have. But I know this. You be with God who you need to be. You get real with God. You pray with him. You go beyond the normal prayer. You spend the time in prayer, and you'll be who you need to be when that cup comes to you. And you can say, not my will, but thy will be done. Romans 8, 31 and 32 says, if God be for us, who can be against us? And he that spared not his own son for our sakes, how shall he not by him freely give us all things? Let's pray. Lord, I pray you receive glory today. You're big, we're not. You're our hope. Without you, we're hopeless. Lord, I pray for my church family, people that I love, care for deeply. I would want them never to have to face hardship, but I know that that's not true. Storm clouds come. But Lord, we can be ready. Lord, teach us to pray in another way. Teach us to get on our knees in a garden and ask for your will. Not your wealth, for your will. Lord, move in this room today. Stir hearts. Does anybody just needs to come and pray at the altar? That's fine. If they pray at their seat, that's fine. But Lord, stir hearts. Don't let us leave the way we came in. Lord, to you be all the glory and the praise forever and ever. Amen.